Hey everyone, I'm Andy Petronic, and this is the Whole Life Challenge podcast. It's the place we talk to exceptional people about the things that make them tick, exploring their life successes, lessons learned, daily habits and secrets, what helped them to get where they are, and how they stay on top of their game. Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Whole Life Podcast. This is Andy Petronic. Man, I love hearing that music back in the beginning of the podcast. We're mixing things up as usual on the podcast, and yet the music's back at the beginning. This is episode number 116, and my guest today is none other than Danny Clark. He's the performance director and master instructor for MovNat. You will be hearing a lot more about MovNat in the podcast, but suffice it to say that Danny Clark is one heck of an amazing guy. He's a, first of all, a coach. He's a world-class athlete. He's a scholar in evolutionary biology and archaeology. And he has an extensive knowledge of exercise science and strength and conditioning programming. This unique skill set really enables him to develop the MovNat curriculum and program, in that he's able to take what are seemingly complex movements from the outdoors and boil them down into, what does it take to do these? What kind of movement progressions are required to do this? He really simplifies it down and has created a curriculum for the instructors of the MovNat program to use in developing their own skills as coaches. Prior to this, Danny was a wrestling and judo master. He had a Division I scholarship to the University of Virginia. But an injury ended his career in wrestling, and he transitioned into Brazilian jiu-jitsu and MMA training. He went on to win a bronze medal. This guy's amazing. Let me just tell you. He went on to win a bronze medal for Team USA at the UWW World Grappling Championships in Krakow, Poland. And while he was doing all this, he kind of immersed himself in many alternative arts, yoga, kettlebell. As you might imagine, he accumulated lots of imbalances and wear and tear on his body from heavy exertion and competition. The most profound program that he found up until that point was when he worked with Erwin LaCour of MovNat. He was the founder of MovNat, and he found that by incorporating Erwin's training and coaching and methods, that he was able to heal years of abuse of his own body and neglect and over specialization. So he's taken that and moved into MovNat's living room, and he is running the program. And he is, if you couldn't already tell, he's an amazing guy. And he's done something really cool for our little podcast community. If you get really inspired listening to the podcast with Danny and you want to check out one of the MovNat certifications around the country, go to MovNat.com, and when you go to check out, enter the code CAPITALS WLC100 in the coupon code, and you'll get $100 off any certification you want to attend anywhere in the country that they offer it. So check that out, and thank you, Danny. He's coming up.
I'm
always tweaking the format of the podcast. And up until now, I've been doing these longish updates of what's going on with me and things I want to talk about. And I've decided to take those, wrap them up into a 5 to 15 minute conversation in a separate podcast episode. They are only going to be available for subscribers to the podcast, because we're not doing a write-up. You can probably find them somewhere on the internet, but we're not doing a write-up for them. So subscribe to the podcast and you'll get them. While we're in the challenge, in the Whole Life Challenge, the topics of these are going to be generally around the lifestyle practice, whatever the lifestyle practice of that week is. And it'll be with a guest that's coming up that week. So Danny and I did one of these. It came out 2 days ago, 3 days ago, about the lifestyle practice this week, which is connecting with others. And we talked for about 10 minutes. It's great. It's actionable. It's short. Check it out. We've done three of them so far with three different guests. Again, subscribe to the podcast. Go to iTunes and subscribe. And yeah, changing gears again. I want to talk about the fan of the week. Yes, I have a fan of the week, and the fan of the week is based on the review of the week. And the review of the week comes from a guy named Bill. Bill underscore FL. He says in his review, Andy is an inspiration. His life of service, fitness, and adventure helps me focus and pushes me beyond my comfort level. I've listened to the podcast for over a year and always find something in it that helps me keep moving along toward the path. The Whole Life Challenge game is a creative way to help me compete, and I love that it is the sole supporter of the podcast. I consider Andy and his team to be members of my, quote, personal board of directors, unquote. Thank you, Bill. I appreciate it. For any of you out there that want to be the fan of the week, all you got to do is leave a review in iTunes. So go to iTunes. Easiest way to get there is with this bit.ly link I created. It's bit.ly, bit.ly. /WLC-podcast. That'll take you, that'll actually open it up in iTunes, because in order to leave a review, you have to go to iTunes. It's crazy. It's a little bit cumbersome, but, you can do that on your phone, or on your desktop. If you do it on your phone, actually, you can click on the, if you're listening on your iTunes podcast app, you can click on the main button on the main screen and click on leave a review, and you can do it right there. So it's probably the easiest. Please do that. It helps us grow the podcast. It helps me get better guests. It helps me get people that are higher profile that only start talking to you when you've got thousands and thousands of people listening to your podcast. I'd like to think I'm important enough to get a conversation with anyone in the world, but lo and behold, people are busy and they have to selectively choose who they're going to spend their time with. And the more people we have listening to the podcast, the better guests we can get. So I appreciate any help I can get with that. And last but not least, before we begin, this show is brought to you by the Whole Life Challenge. We are we're in week 8 of this current challenge. And by now, you guys have heard, some of you have heard, maybe some of you haven't heard, we're moving to a 6-week format in 2018. We're going to be doing 4 6-week Whole Life Challenges over the course of the year. And we're only going to have 6 weeks in between each Whole Life Challenge during the year. So it's going to be a completely new experience. We're doing this from the standpoint of player success. We believe that getting more people to finish the challenge, which will definitely happen if it's only 6 weeks long, will leave them with a better taste in their mouth. We'll leave them wanting more. We'll leave them wanting to re-engage after 6 weeks, or maybe after 12 weeks, or 24 weeks. They don't have to be back to back. And that, being willing to engage on a regular, consistent basis, is really the foundation for long-term change in life. So that's what we're going for, and that's why we made the change. So it's not too early to register. The next challenge doesn't begin till January 20th, but please consider it now. If you know you're going to do it, you might as well do it now. It's cheap. It's the cheapest right now. It's $24 for any returning player. So do it. Don't wait. Don't procrastinate. If you know you're going to do it and you want to do it in January, do it now. All right. Oh, lastly, a little note. For more details and info from this episode, don't forget you can check out the full note the full show notes at wholelifechallenge.com/podcast. Got that? Do it. There's a lot there. A lot of links. A lot of bullet points. And by the way, if you're listening and enjoying the show, I'd love for you to take a screenshot of your screen, of you listening, wherever you are, listening in your car, listening on a boat, listening, whatever you're up to, maybe doing the dishes. Take a screenshot and tag me. I'd love to connect with you and hear about your experience of listening to the podcast, where you do it, because it's always a question for me where people listen to these things. A lot of people are in their car, I know. So let's get on with the episode. Get ready for the one, the only, Danny Clark. Danny Clark, welcome to the Whole Life Podcast.
Hey, brother. Thanks so much for having me.
It was so awesome to have you as the MovNat coach in videos for the last, let's see, you guys have done two challenges now.
Yep. We did at the beginning of 2017, and then we did the spring one going into summer.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because I didn't do a lot of work in knowing more about who you are or I knew about Irwin and MovNat, but in preparing for this podcast, I just read your bio. I went to Rebar Fitness, and I just learned a bit more about you, which is cool. Like it's cool. I love the depth of, and one of the reasons I do the podcast is I love to learn more about people and get to know their, you know, humanity and their history and their story. And
sure.
Just very intrigued by you've got quite a background. I mean, it's funny because when I learned about your wrestling and fighting, and I remember when I first met you and shook your hand, like looking at your arm and the way your elbow was put together, like I remember thinking, okay, this guy's either a longshoreman or like there's something more to this than he's just a movement coach, because it just the way you're built is not, there's, you're very hearty, very, very you know, well structured.
Thank you. Well, if there's one area I get some male admiration on, it is my forearm. So
yeah.
It's probably a byproduct of being a wrestler, and you know, continuing to nurture that through what I do now. But thank you, I appreciate that.
What did your So tell us a little bit about your background and how you got where you are. Like I know we could probably spend 3 hours talking about that stuff, but in a Reader's Digest version,
sure.
Yeah, how did you get here?
Yeah, so I started, I guess for me, it started really with wrestling. So I started wrestling when I was turning 5 years old, so very, very young. And I had some really, really good coaches throughout the years. And I always tell my students this as I teach a MovNat certification. I remember sitting down with one of my really good coaches or walking into practice, and we're all gathered around getting ready to, you know, learn whatever we're going to learn that day. And he had it. These chalkboards on the side of the wrestling room, and on these chalkboards were all these techniques that were organized all the way from takedowns to takedown defenses, takedown setups, you know, the whole gamut. And we would just go through and work on optimizing technique in each of these particular techniques. And that's how, you know, by doing that, he produced a lot of really world-class athletes, a lot of world-class wrestlers over time. And you know, so right there, that was sort of a profound experience for me, just seeing that just by really focusing on how you do something as opposed to just sort of doing it and hoping for the best and just kind of going through the motions or just being aggressive like a lot of people in that sport do, you can actually get better really, really fast, and you can have a lot of success. So in a lot of ways, even my coaching career started there, just observing that. Then, you know,
where was that? What state were you, did this occur? Cause like wrestling is not something that might not naturally occur if you were growing up in, I don't know, grew up in Maryland. I don't think Maryland is known for wrestling, even California, not so much.
No, I was sort of in the kind of belt of, or the, I guess it'd be the trifecta of wrestling. That being, I was in New Jersey, but you know, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Ohio are kind of the big three, mm-hmm. for high school and youth wrestling. So I was in New Jersey. So this took place in Northern New Jersey, with a coach named Ernie Monaco, who ran a wrestling club called The Edge. And, you know, again, he produced a lot of really, really high level, super successful wrestlers. I'm not on that list, but I was certainly privileged to be a part of the team and part of the educational experience.
Well, I think you're quite humble. Like you definitely have some notches on your belt that are far surpass the normal high school kid just wrestling for fun.
Yeah. No, absolutely. So my wrestling career took me through college. I wrestled at the University of Virginia. My career didn't take off exactly there. I was kind of riddled with some injuries, specifically some head injuries. So that sort of fizzled out and had to take a little bit of a break.
What kind of head injuries? Like concussion type?
Yeah, concussions. Huh. Yeah, unfortunately.
Is that a normal injury in wrestling? Like, it's not something I would think of in wrestling, concussions.
It's pretty common. Not as common as you would see in a sport like football, where you're just like outright, you know,
bashing
into each other, or boxing, where you're, you know, where there's punches involved. But you know, one of your primary tools that you use as your primary defense and offense in wrestling is your head. So a lot of clashing happens. It's usually not at the force level that would cause a concussion, but being a bigger guy, you know, I wrestled in the 184, 197 kind of realm. You know, I oftentimes was against some big, burly, thick neck, you know, like dudes. And
because you're wrestling at that weight, but you're cutting to that weight, and then you're putting on how much time is between the weigh-in and the fight
for wrestling? Usually it's the same day.
So you don't have 20 unlike, you don't have 24 hours to like just go crazy.
Usually not. So mixed martial arts is the sport where that happens, where you can you know, weigh in the night before and then fight the next day. And, you know, so that these guys can do these crazy 40-pound weight cuts to the point where they, you know, I don't know what the situation is these days, but in my day, you know, the first thing they did was stick in and, you know, an IV to rehydrate, something you can't do with wrestling. But it actually makes it a little bit more dangerous, because you're dehydrating yourself to these super, super, super low levels of fluid in your body, and then you're wrestling not too far thereafter. So that's a whole conversation in itself. Don't particularly miss very much, but certainly prepared me and helped forge a lot of discipline in my life, which is also a really good thing. So it's a double-edged sword in a lot of ways. But, and you know, in terms of concussions, it's not like the most common thing ever to, you know, wrestling. Most wrestlers phase out because of knees or shoulders. So going out by concussions was sort of happenstance for me. I had gotten a couple concussions, and I got two in a row that were really, really bad. And it just really sidelined me for a while, and just took if I had more time to recover, I would have probably been fine, because I ended up switching over to another grappling art anyway. But I just, at that time, I couldn't even really go to school. Like, I was having trouble like understanding a sentence for like 4 or 5 weeks there. So it just took a while to recover. And then my body just kind of told me like no for a little while after that, for, you know, even a couple of years. And then, so I just had to phase out. I had to do what I felt like was right for my body in a lot of ways, and what my doctors felt like was right for my body.
What did your parents have to say about it all? Were they influential in this?
Yeah. My dad's always been my biggest supporter, and well, my mom, of course, too. But my dad, in a more direct way, as a fellow martial artist, and he, you know, just been supportive. You know, like, showed concern, but understood the process. You know, like, he would have been okay either way. Of course, being a parent, wanted the best for my life. You know, he understood the way he saw it is, you know, wrestling was a tool that got me into a better school than I probably would have purely on grade. So I think he also wanted to make sure I got the most out of that experience as well. And I did, by listening to my body. So that was good.
Was he an influencing factor? And was he a wrestler or a grappler or a martial artist was, you know, early on in your life?
He was a judoka. So a lot of time in judo. He dabbled in some wrestling, but the majority of his time was spent in judo. And that was one of my influences as well. I spent a lot of time in my youth doing judo, which if you're not familiar, it's a grappling art as well, but it's more about throwing someone than it is about taking them down. And there's really almost no groundwork or ground grappling going on in that sport.
Once they hit the ground, it's done. The fight's over or the points scored or whatever, right? Is that how it works, kind of?
Yeah, there's not really any points associated with the ground. Basically, if you throw them to the ground, you got about 15 seconds to submit them. Or the only other way you can finish them is if you hold them down on their back for, I think it's a minute. It's been a while since I've done this, but so if you just hold them down in a particular head and arm lock, or if you submit them, but if you're just kind of grappling, scrambling around, or if you're caught in their guard or anything, like, they're going to stand you right back up, because most of the point system is based on the throws.
Ah, got it. So you get them for throwing them to the ground. You score. You do score. The match isn't over, but you score points, and so that's a good thing in judo.
Well, if you throw them with what would be near a perfect throw, where they land basically flat on their shoulder blades, the match is over. All it takes, a match can be over in 10 seconds. You know, you can go out there, one good throw, you know, where they basically go hips overhead and end up on their back, the match is over.
Wow.
And it's, like, out of all the grappling arts, honestly, I think judo is one of the best spectator sports. Like, if you watch the Olympics, it's incredible, these guys, how they fight, and just the technique and the ferocity. And it's a very, unlike something like jiu-jitsu, where there's a lot of, like, subtle technique going on the ground, and it's just sort of two dudes wrapped together in a pretzel.
Exactly. It looks like two, like, boa constrictors, you know, like, and there's not a lot of action a lot of times. So there's not a lot of action.
Totally.
Have you ever connected with Tim Thackeray over the years? Do you know who Tim is? He was a judo. He used to run CrossFit High Voltage up in Burbank, and has since stopped. But I think he was an Olympian. I think he actually went to the Olympics in judo.
I really followed it.
Yeah, whenever I think of judo, I think of Tim. He's quite a great guy.
It's, you know, I think grappling arts are just such incredibly beautiful displays of athleticism. Of course, all the discipline behind it, almost to the point of insanity.
Right.
But yeah, it's they're just great arts. I truly respect them, and it's one of those sports that is really hard to cultivate that deep respect for unless you do it, you know? So I was very fortunate to be immersed in that culture from a very young age, because I took so much from it.
How did, what are some of the things you took that you think back to now around how you conduct your life? Some of the virtues perhaps that you bring into the current way of being that you got from an early age because of your training?
Yeah, a few things stand out. One is definitely just confidence. I think especially as a man, it's just knowing that I can handle myself in a confrontation just has always carried with me through life. And I really, in my life, I'm trying to think, I've never really even gotten into a street fight or confrontation.
Right.
But a lot of it's because, you know, you carry a combination of capability, which is going to be reflected in your body language and your stature. But also you carry some humility at the same time, because I don't need to go prove myself to anybody how competent of a fighter I am. So nice. I don't need to fight, but if I had to, I could. And knowing that is really, really important as I move through life, especially as a father, as a protector. So that's one big thing. The other thing is definitely the discipline, for sure. You know, so like starting at a young age and understanding that if I am able to, you know, sort of not fall trap to some of the sensory needs of the body, right? Like, so like feeling like that I can deal with hunger, I could deal with thirst, I can deal with even socially, like not having a super strong social life at periods of time, like kind of just being able to like deal with deprivation a little bit
of the feelings, the feelings that can overwhelm people and derail them in life.
Totally. Yeah. Right. I think that's a huge thing. Like to be able to know that, hey, this I'm going through the storm right now. It's for a good reason. And on the other side, I'll get through it. And a lot of times, you know, sometimes the signals our body give us are a lot stronger than what's actually needed, you know? So being able to sort of get to the basics, be able to have the discipline to accomplish what I want to accomplish within reason, definitely has carried over into my life in so many different ways, from my professional life to my personal life to my continued physical life. It's just a valuable tool to have and not to abuse, you know. I don't think that we're supposed to totally deprive and live this super Spartan life. I don't think that's the point of health, but I do think that having that skill is also healthy too, because realistically we're not going to be always able to scratch every itch and desire we have.
Right.
So, and then the last thing being just the technical mindset that I got from wrestling. And that's, you know, why I like to talk about that chalkboard right from the beginning is, what I do now is I help people move more naturally. So by taking a technical mindset to that, by understanding that technique and movement competence is more important, or at least a huge foundation before trying to build on capacity and aggressiveness or strength or whatever, you know, being able to mindfully apply technique and perform better in life or in movements is really, really something else I took from wrestling. So kind of became a full circle for me and what I do now for my career in a lot of ways. So
yeah, right.
That's a huge part of it. And jiu-jitsu did a good job with that too, because, you know, I transitioned from wrestling to jiu-jitsu / mixed martial arts, and jiu-jitsu is actually a lot more technical than wrestling in many ways, especially how we approach wrestling in the United States anyway. The Russians tend to be a lot more technical with their wrestling. We tend to be much more like just, you know, pure brute conditioning and strength and power and explosiveness and mental toughness. But jiu-jitsu is the opposite. It's about relaxing, finding the path of efficiency, finding efficiency in technique so you can outsmart your partner in a lot of ways without wasting energy. So that more cerebral mindset of jiu-jitsu really was helpful for me as well, because again, that's the same way we approach movements with MovNat.
Yeah, no, I can see the correlation and how valuable that experience. I mean, you've basically been doing it your whole life. So developing the MovNat training and the kind of physical training that you do now, helping people discover that, I mean, it fits like tongue in groove. It's perfect.
Yeah, it does. And that's, you know, for me, being a trainer, like I transitioned after college to being a trainer, and I wanted to help inject some of that feeling of competence, of strength, and of feeling just how amazing it feels to move and be free into my clients' lives. That's a lot of the driving force of what got me into that. And a lot to my dismay, I felt like the toolkit that I was given from a fitness perspective, that being sort of the bodybuilding culture that was around when I started, and even the strength and conditioning culture that I knew from wrestling, supplementing with wrestling, just wasn't doing the job in a lot of ways for giving that same feeling that I had. So, you know, for me, it became sort of like a necessary step to inject a lot of that stuff.
How did you start? How did you get started in the training world? Because you graduated from college, I'm guessing. And your degree, was it in exercise science or?
No, it was actually, I did a double major in biology and archaeology.
Of course you did.
I know.
It makes perfect sense.
So, it all makes sense. I know.
Jesus Christ.
I know. I've been on a crash course with this for a long time.
You're like you're Indiana Jones and combined with, you're like Superman. Superman and Indiana Jones wrapped up in one.
A compliment. Thank you. You'd say the same for yourself right now.
Yeah, I'm not a biologist. I just studied geology for, you know.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of time in the environmental science department. That's probably why I ended up, I actually did archaeology because it was like, I took so many classes in environmental science and human evolution and even anthropology to max out the biology broadening out your horizons beyond molecular biology stuff, that my dean was like, listen, you need like a field study just to do an archaeology major, so you should do that. I was like, sure.
That's cool.
But geology is super cool.
It is cool. I mean, I think back to it, and I didn't think it was so cool at the time. I did it, basically, I was a junior, and I was like, okay, I hadn't declared my major, and I'd taken a crap load of random courses, you know, random, most, I was involved in, I liked sciences and I liked math and but there was nothing that like just caught me and like, okay, I want to study this. And, basically, it's embarrassing. Geology was the only one that I could complete without, you know, completely overwhelming my schedule, my junior and senior years. And still graduate on time. Nice. So I was like, okay, I'm a geology major. And,
awesome.
But I loved, I mean, there were elements of it I loved. I didn't particularly like having to figure out and know what all the rocks and minerals were, like flashcards and rocks and minerals, but studying the strata and the layers and coral reefs and in, you know, the layers laid down by volcanoes and volcanic stuff and like the Grand Canyon kind of stuff and earthquakes, and that stuff was cool.
There's a lot of systems in geology, and that's always a fascinating understanding how natural systems work. And in a lot of ways, it's the same with the human body. So it ties into what you're doing.
Yeah, I guess it does. I never really thought about that, but interesting.
Totally.
So anyway, so you graduated, and what did you move on? Did you move into like the physical training world immediately, or what transpired there?
Gold's Gym, baby.
Really?
Oh yeah.
Wow. Where was that?
This is the right where UVA is in Charlottesville, Virginia.
Oh really?
And it was a great move because I ended up meeting my wife there, so that was really cool.
Cool.
But yeah, I was, you know, after wrestling was over, I was in a bit of a lull between sports, and I was kind of lost in a lot of ways, you know, as you can imagine, like this was such a huge part of my life, this pursuit of, you know, wrestling excellence or whatever, you know, like trying to get to the highest level possible. And then that was removed. And, you know, education was really cool. Having more of a social life was pretty neat. But I still felt this void in physicality for sure. You know, I'm a very physical person just by nature at that point, by primary nature and second nature at that point. So, you know, I started just doing what I was doing on the off season for wrestling, which was strength and conditioning. So, you know, power cleans and jerks and squats and deadlifts and all the classic movements. So I really needed that in my life. So I just started training at a Gold's Gym.
Yourself? To continue. Training
myself.
Yourself.
Yeah. Because at the, you know, UVA, it's, you know, it's a better school. Not a lot of people actually go to the gym. So it wasn't really set up to be able to do power lifts, you know, or Olympic lifts.
Right.
So I would go to the Gold's Gym. Where
I'm impressed, actually, the Gold's Gym had that capability, because I actually started, believe it or not, at Gold's Gym too, but in Gold's Gym in Venice, the Mecca, and they didn't have any power.
Yeah.
There was no power. There was no Olympic weightlifting. There were no bumper plates. There were no platforms. It was all bodybuilding.
Nope. There was none of that there either. But I just,
you just did it anyway.
There was like five dudes fighting over a squat rack in a small little place at UVA. Right. So I was just like, all right, I'll go somewhere where there's five squat racks.
Got it.
It was more of that. It was a challenge to do the Olympic lifts like that because I had to set them down. I couldn't drop them or anything like that. But
Funny story, my first overhead squat actually started when I learned what CrossFit was, but I had no idea the demands on the body in an overhead squat. And I think the recommendation was, you know, don't start with more than, I want to say an empty bar. But of course I thought, well, geez, I'm fit and strong. I should be able to do 95 pounds. So I put 95 pounds on, these are not bumper plates. These are cast iron plates. And I stuck it on the thing and I stuck it on the squat rack. Of course, I didn't know grip. I didn't know, I'd basically done nothing. Just thinking I'm a fit guy who does squats and deadlifts and, you know, I can do this. And I put the weight up over my head, probably, you know, with a fairly narrow grip. And I wasn't actually in the rack. It was one of those weird racks, you know, those racks that it's not a cage. It's got safety bars, and then it goes up at an angle away from you. So I had
That was the old school squat rack.
Yeah,
that everybody had. Yep.
And I had moved completely out of it for the overhead squat, like no safety bars. And I get down halfway, and I immediately start to notice this
this is something doesn't feel right, but you know, I can do this. Power through. And I got to a point where it everything failed simultaneously, and the bar comes down. You know, this is in a very quiet private training gym mostly, and I mean, plates flying, bars flying, I'm flying. It was pretty freaking hilarious.
Yeah. And you know, like, that's a hard movement to lock something out overhead like that, especially if you haven't done it ever, right? So I remember even learning at UVA, I had a really, really good strength coach. And he taught really, really excellent technique, which served me a lot, of course, later in life with Olympic lifting. But even still, because of the lack of mobility, that even, you know, us, I don't know what we were, 20 or lower. I mean, we had almost more injuries in the weight room than we did in the wrestling room.
And I would think you'd have plenty of mobility as a wrestler. Like I, in my limited knowledge of wrestling, I haven't really been around many wrestlers. In my mind, think, well, they're flexible. I mean, they have to be able to move their body in three dimensions, you know, twisting, right, turning, extending, you know, like a gymnast. I actually have you guys kind of in a similar category of gymnasts in my head.
It's a pretty balanced art in the sense that we do a lot of ground movement. So we're very flexible, usually in the hips, especially, and the torso, shoulders, sort of, in a way, because, you know, you're reaching for legs and then you get sprawled on and you're extended. But there's a lot that's done in the sagittal plane, in the sense that you're hunched forward, your head's forward, your arms are forward, your shoulders are forward to protect yourself.
Right.
So it's sort of the opposite movement of a snatch. Most, again, there's stylistic differences. There's going to be the guy who's Mr., you know, we would call Gumby, the wrestler, who can do like anything and would have no problem with that. They would have more probably trouble with the stability of a movement like a snatch.
Yep.
But then there's the people like myself who are I'm much more wired for explosiveness. So my style was much more explosive, fast. You know, for compared to an average 20-year-old, my flexibility was good. But certainly, you know, an overhead snatch or a snatch, any type of snatch, any overhead lockout requires a tremendous amount of mobility, especially in the, you know, in the shoulders and in the T-spine. So I would not say that most wrestlers would have that even at that age.
Interesting.
Just based on what I witnessed, most didn't. Or especially the bigger guys, you know, the ones that are, again, 170 and above, their style is not usually Gumby, because you try to do that and you're going to dislocate your joint with all that weight and pressure on it.
Well, you've got that continuum, that flexibility, strength, stability continuum, you know, and I think that's one of the things a lot of people don't really recognize in the body. You know, the people that are tight always think, well, the mother load is to be Gumby, and the people that are Gumby, you know, maybe some of the, I don't know if many of them think, well, the mother load is to be strong. I tend to think, being around a lot of yoga people, I don't know that they realize that they should be stronger to stabilize their joints better, so they prevent, you know, the constant dislocation or threat of dislocation and injury.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, I agree that there's trade-offs. That's what you learn with everything, is there's always trade-offs. So I think that health lies in the middle for sure. So any of those extremes, being extremely stable or strong, but only in a very small limited range of motion, and at the same time being very, you know, almost hypermobile or even flexible, even if you're not hypermobile, but not having the stability to match it, isn't necessarily a good thing. And of course, we at MovNat have a kind of unique perspective on that, but I agree that strength is a way to sort of find, you know, you got to practice somehow strength and range of motion. You got to have them coupled together and in a way that's appropriate to where you're not destroying your joints. So that's the challenge. I think that's the holy grail that many look for.
Yeah.
But especially a westernized version of yoga, where the goal or one of the primary goals is flexibility, you do see a lot of instability, I would agree. And I'm not sure what the awareness seems to be increasing that, like, that's not super healthy or
It does seem to be. Yeah. Right. But yeah. It's an interesting thing. Like, it's, you know, I've always looked at gymnasts as the kind of the all around best combination of both. But most people don't have the 4 to 6 hours a day to commit to the training that it takes to get there. And I, you know, because I know the rigors of
flexibility, but the flexibility just takes much, much longer. The connective tissue doesn't respond as quickly as muscle. It doesn't have the same blood flow. It doesn't have the same nutrient density or capability. It's not supposed to do that. Right. So it just takes a lot more consistent practice and much longer. You know,
it takes a lot of time. And I can see where I would partially agree with you that the gymnast is the icon of strength and flexibility. But in a lot of ways, they're also sort of behind the scenes, the icon of injury, too.
Right,
you know,
so right, like, right. No, right. I agree with you. Yeah.
You know, so there's so many. I basically every gymnast I know, especially that started early, is in chronic pain at this point. So,
yeah, my wife is a great example. She's got one wrist. She had reconstructive wrist surgery, and one wrist, I don't know if you can see, but Danny and I are on video, by the way, for all you guys, so I'm showing him my wrist angle. One wrist goes to here, and one wrist goes to here. And, you know, she can't do a front squat. She can't do, anything. She can't even really do handstands anymore. She goes up into a handstand and immediate pain in her wrist. And she had the greatest handstand. When I first met her, she wasn't in as much pain as she is now. And, she taught me a lot about my first gymnastic, the story of me doing a handstand in our living room without moving any of the furniture. And, you know, I'm not a gymnast. And just the screams from her, like, no, because I'm like a ticking time bomb. I go up and I come down, and I had no idea how to really come out of it. I'm like, it's kind of like me in the overhead squat. Like, I should be able to do this. I'm a fit person, you know, like how hard could this be? And, you know, crashing into the coffee table, crashing into the, it's not a good, not a advisable way to go. But so you're right. Gymnasts are injured. A lot of them.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you look at what the demands of the sport are. You're asking for the highest level of flexibility and strength put together, which, it's very polarized. So it's very beautiful, right? You can get the best of both worlds in a way. But I don't see it as a way that our joints are naturally intended to either A, go into certain ranges of motion to that degree.
Right.
There's definitely a range that is, from a biological perspective, natural. Mm-hmm. And B, that level of training that you already mentioned, I don't think that that's biologically very natural either.
Yeah, right.
To
put
yourself through that. And in a lot of ways, I was confronted with that in my own journey, because as I had my professional journey and my personal journey, as I mentioned, I was doing a lot of strength and conditioning and was doing everything very like technical, very balanced, you know, push, pull, hinge, squat, making sure everything was very, very balanced in a lot of ways, very meticulous, made sure I could do a single leg squat all the way to the ground. Full, everything felt full range of motion, but my body was still breaking down. My lower back was, I had bulging discs, some of this residual from wrestling, but it was being exacerbated by what I was doing. And my neck was a disaster, just tension everywhere. So in my own quest, that kind of became like, okay, so powerlifting or strength and conditioning isn't getting me where I would need to be. I feel worse, less energized. You know, at a particular time in my life, it was serving me well, but really, that's not the way we're intended to move. We know this, even because I was using it as a supplement to athletic performance. It wasn't the way I move, you know? Mm-hmm. So anyway.
You were doing jiu-jitsu at the time too, right? You were not just strength and conditioning in the gym.
I was doing some jiu-jitsu. I went through a period of where I did no wrestling. I switched to jiu-jitsu / MMA for about 8 or 9 years. And then in my last very big competition, I got an injury on my knee, to which I healed. And then when I came back, I got an elbow to the face, and I was not wearing a mouth guard, so it broke my tooth. So ooh. I've been out for a little bit. So as this is going on, this kind of train of thought I'm talking about, I was actually just purely strength training, doing strength and conditioning mostly. Okay.
And this is, you're 28 at this point, you're 30. Like, how old were you when this was?
Just about 30.
Okay. And how old are you now? Well, I have no idea where. You look 30. Like you look like you're like 25. So I have no idea.
Thank you.
33. Thank you. Okay, so that gives me some context.
Yeah, of course. So I was sort of confronted with that. I'm like, okay, how do I deal with this? I was working with a very brilliant physical therapist, and was very fortunate to understand my body at a better level. So even I can refine my technique further. I could do corrective exercise. I can roll, you know, I could do soft tissue work to try to work some of this stuff out. But in my mind, I'm like, do I just want to do correctives for the rest of my life? Do I want to foam roll for the rest of my life? Like, is that really what movement is going to be to me? Foam roll, corrective exercise, then the deadlift. Like, that's it. And you know, some variations thereof of everything. So I was just sort of disheartened by that in a lot of ways, and just want I like to consider myself a problem solver and a truth seeker. I just wanted to know, like, how do I take all these lessons I've learned, especially from physical therapy, and ingrain them into my life in a more fluid, natural way?
Before we move to the next step, because I think I know where you're going, which is great. I want to go there, but I want to ask you first, were you training clients at this point? Were you had a big training business?
At this point, yes. I had run a gym on my own after Gold's Gym. In a very small, beautiful town in the Northwest, which I loved. And that did fairly well, but, you know, not enough to have a full family and be able to travel back to see our family and stuff. So we ended up going back east and starting a gym there, which is Rebar Fitness, which was sort of the last step before I transitioned to MoveNat.
Okay.
So Rebar Fitness was in Connecticut. It was, it still is. It's still going. It was a lot of just, you know, executives, like CEOs of companies, folks that were 40 plus, even 50 and 60 plus. And so in a lot of ways, my own journey was paralleling theirs, because they're coming to me in pain, unable to really do anything. Even something basic like a deadlift was a challenge, right? So I'm also thinking to myself from a professional perspective, like, is what I'm teaching these people serving them as best as I can?
Right.
In terms of addressing the stiffness or the instability, you know, there's that classic, you know, male overly tight, female overly stiff, overly instable and in pain. Yep. So, you know, I just was like, okay, am I really serving my clients the best I could be using kettlebells, using FMS correctives?
Yeah. What was your training up to that point? Like, what kinds of modalities had you trained in to bring your clients this stuff you were doing?
Yep. So after college, I, of course, did, I was understood, you know, I understood, of course, at Gold's Gym, you know, the rite of passage of learning how to isolate muscles and build a bicep. So
that's right. I was look in the mirror. Yeah. I want it right here. I want that third head of the tricep. How do I isolate that muscle?
I got to isolate my upper abs and my lower abs.
Yes. Yes. So,
got kind of the school of hard knocks there. And, you know, I wanted to bring in the strength and conditioning that I had learned. So I, you know, ended up doing the strength.
Something happened. Are we back?
We're back.
Okay, here we go. You're back.
Okay. Cool. What should I start with?
Well, let's see. You froze at you were talking about rite of passage, Gold's Gym.
Did you hear the School of Hard Knocks part?
I think that was the last thing you said.
Cool. All right, so after the School of Hard Knocks, I at the same time was doing still my Olympic lifting and my power lifting, because that was stuff I had done through college and had refined technique in fairly well, and wanted to learn more about how to teach some of that, even plyometrics. So I got more into classical strength and conditioning, you know, all the way, you know, did research all the way back to the classical GPP stuff, and got my certified strength and conditioning certification through the NSCA. And you know, just doing the classic strength coach thing. Had my mentor from my coach in college who was helping me. So I was trying to get people to, you know, move in a more functional way, just like, you know, I'm sure you're very familiar with CrossFit, and you know, just doing more of the classical Soviet science way. And
were you having people standing on one foot or on Bosu balls and doing all the you know, all the Swiss ball things or any of those things, or were you more traditional in your approach?
No, definitely more. And at the same time, I was learning from, I started training with kettlebells under Pavel.
Oh, cool.
And Pavel, that was a beautiful marriage between the two, because Pavel, of course, comes from that same lineage of, you know, Soviet sports science, when the Soviets were trying to figure out how to take over the, you know, world domination through athletics and through other means. So I really believed in the simplicity of strength and of that model of strength and conditioning. And Pavel's kettlebells were a great way to bring that to more people without it being so barbell influenced and strength influenced. It was a little bit more submaximal, a little bit more range of motion involved. So those two things came together after the School of Hard Knocks time period at Gold's Gym. And I injected it into my training and was definitely, in, you know, especially when I started the gym beyond that, it was all focused primarily on kettlebell training, mostly.
Okay, cool.
Yep. So that was sort of my background with, you know, strength and conditioning. And that's kind of what brought me eventually to that juncture where I was like, okay, where do I go from here? Because I feel like I'm doing everything right and I'm really paying attention to technique. I've achieved, you know, a bunch of, I did some powerlifting type competitions to where I did like Pavel's Beast Tamer, where you press a 106-pound kettlebell and pistol it and then do a pull-up with it chained to you. Huh. So I'm like, okay, I know I'm structurally pretty sound. So like, what is going on here? What is the matter?
Had you also, you know, we haven't really talked about nutrition or other elements besides physical conditioning. Had you brought that stuff into your practice either with yourself or with your clients?
Yes, of course. I, you know, ended up, my wife did the precision nutrition certification and I did another one. And, so yeah, I took a lot of that into account for sure. For my clients mostly, I applied it a little bit to myself. But from my, one of the things that my parents did pretty well for me was create good meals. So like I didn't have too much trouble personally with that side of it.
What was a good meal to your parents? Like, I mean, my mom had a definition of a good meal and it doesn't line up with, it doesn't necessarily line up with what I would consider to be a good meal today.
Yeah. Really, I mean, really quite simply, I ate real food for the most part.
Great.
You know, right. And for me, like, you know, and this is a funny topic because, you know, I had a lot of success with my clients using a more science outcome-based approach to nutrition that precision nutrition mostly uses, where we're measuring to improve, basically. Mm-hmm. We're using body fat analysis. We're sort of fine-tuning, you know, meals and macronutrient ratios to, for certain clients anyway, and habits to get them to, you know, to see measurable progress in terms of body composition, making sure that they're not, you know, burning fat at the expense of muscle, all the kind of basics that most people are, I think, mostly aware of by now. And then that's sort of when the paleo thing hit, right? So like Rob's stuff was coming out and I was getting pressure from my clients to go that route in a lot of ways because, you know, they sort of thought it was the holy grail. Like, this makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure talking to me right now, you're probably thinking, as the dude who's interested in evolutionary biology and evolutionary movement, I must have been like, yeah.
Right.
But I was actually really, really resistant to it at the time, both for two reasons. One, I wasn't fully educated in it enough. So I was hearing from secondary sources what it was and what the rules were. And I didn't really like the rules because they didn't really make a lot of sense to me from an evolutionary perspective. You know, I think that there was a lot of interesting science behind it. But I knew that across a lot, especially with the anthropology background, across a lot of different human populations, there was a lot of different types of food and macronutrient ratios and types of consumption. So these rules of like, oh, it's got to be super low carb and, you know, almond flour, everything sort of just didn't resonate with me. I was like, well, I mean, it doesn't have to be that way. And I knew for myself, in a lot of ways, it didn't have to be that way. And now, especially after a lot of experimentation, I just don't do really well on a low carb diet personally. I've gotten myself into ketosis and done that. And as somebody who's naturally, if anything, I feel like my gift is to be more powerful and explosive. That's what I do naturally better. I don't do really well on a super low carb diet.
Well, it's interesting because I don't see paleo as super low carb.
Right.
Necessarily. I mean, it could be, certainly could be if you eliminate all grains, all starches, all, you know, you'd have to eat a crap load of vegetables to get the number of carbs you probably were getting if you were eating bread and rice and pasta. But
I would totally agree with you, Andy. I'm primarily going off of the information like really early on, you know, and it was sort of like, oh, this is what it is. It's like, hunter gatherers didn't eat any carbs. They only ate meat and fat, right. You know, like the early phase of it.
Got
but
it.
I would agree
Got
with
it.
You now that, really I probably do eat paleo now because right. I'm eating whole foods and, I don't, you know, I work in a intuitive ratio now that works for me, but, so yeah, I mean, I would not at all argue that paleo is the way to go in a lot of ways.
But are grains part of your regime now? Do you have some grains? Do you limit your grains? How do you feel about that?
I try to balance overall throughout my day, a balance, my carb sources coming from fruits, potatoes, and grains. I do grains. I respond like certain grains I don't do super well with, like I just listening to my body, like rice I don't respond super well to, but for whatever reason, oatmeal, like my body just hums when I take it and when I have it. So especially post workout. So I don't limit grains necessarily. So I mm-hmm. guess, you know, again, that's something that might diverge from some people who view paleo.
Well, but what I really love about what you're saying is, and this is something that I have done a lot of work in, is being your own, you know, N=1 experiment. You know, like
totally.
There is no right answer for everyone, and I think that's one of the big messages of the Whole Life Challenge and me, and you know, there's no formula. There's no, I mean, as much as you'd like it to be, you know, you could try something and try it on and see if it works, but you won't really know unless you're willing to experiment in and out of the rules of that system, whatever system it is you're doing. And if you're not choosing a system, you have a system because you were born with a system. You learned a system. And if you're saying to yourself, what system is he talking about? It's the system that you're already doing because it's your life.
Sure. Right.
You know, being able to play with that, even if there are small changes, you know, I always talk about my story with Diet Coke and how I was hopelessly addicted to Diet Coke and Red Bull. I was sponsored by Red Bull for years. And first Whole Life Challenge rolled around and like, okay, no more Diet Coke. And that was catastrophic. And I haven't had a Diet Coke since, you know, that was 6-7 years ago, which is phenomenal. I mean, look, if that's the only change I made as a result of the Whole Life Challenge, that's pretty significant. I mean, I don't know how many I was drinking. Yeah. You could have made the argument that because I would go out to lunch and go to a place that was a sit down place with a fountain for, you know, as unlimited refills. I have 6 refills, 7 refills of Diet Coke. I mean, it was embarrassing sometimes. Like if you couldn't get up and refill it yourself and you had to call on the waiter. I mean, they should have just brought a pitcher out of Diet Coke. I would drink so much of it.
And
so,
does Diet Coke have caffeine in it too?
Diet Coke does have caffeine.
Was that a tough part? Like, did you substitute that part of it or was it?
I don't really remember.
Diet?
You know what I did do is I bought a Soda Stream and I substituted the carbonation. I got the carbonation in just water. I threw away all the flavored packets that came with the Soda Stream and I just carbonated my water and that became
That's
my
smart.
Thing. And I've been doing that ever since. I mean, I still have my Soda Stream today. I do some of that. I do some Pellegrino. I love bubbly water.
So it turns out you were actually partially addicted to the sensation, which to substitute, you know, like there's definitely worse things in the world than being addicted to the sensation of bubbles on your tongue. Right. So
right.
That's cool that you could substitute that out and still feel gratified.
And what a cool realization. It's just a little tweak, you know, like it was,
right.
This is just a longer way of getting to the point of your modifications for your life. You know, oatmeal's bad. Really? Well, not for me. You know, like
yeah.
I think there's some more universal truths, you know, like you
sure.
could pretty safely say that, you know, drinking a Coke or the equivalent amount of sugar, you know, 12 teaspoons of sugar in your milk, there's not a lot of positiveness if you do that on a consistent basis that you can really take from that. You take it once in preparation for a fight or in to give you energy. Okay. Okay. You could even make a case for that's okay. Maybe.
Sure.
But when it comes to these borderline, these gray areas, there are a lot of gray areas in nutrition.
I think that, again, you got to test it against the ultimate truth, which is how are you functioning? How do you feel? You know, like, do you have, does your stomach hurt? Do you have consistent, strong energy levels throughout the day? Do you enjoy moving? Mm-hmm. Do you feel emotionally balanced in life? Like, if any of this stuff is out of whack, something is out of whack, and it's up to you to figure out what that is. For me, you know, I knew that oatmeal wasn't contributing to anything that was dysfunctional about my body. You know, and so even, you know, I got lab tested and stuff. So to me, I feel very comfortable. I don't feel, I'm not afraid at all of oatmeal in the same way that I'm not afraid of fats or anything.
When you say you got lab tested, you got your blood tested based on, is that when you said lab tested? You didn't lab test the oatmeal.
No, I didn't lab test the oatmeal. It's my own biochemistry.
Right.
I swear there's no anti-nutrients in it. No. just my own hormone profile, my own, you know, urine profile, all that stuff. And, you know, for the most part, things were in check. So, you know, I see that as one way to judge these type of things.
Sure.
You know, so it's, yeah, I think nutrition is so much to me more of a gray area than movement. It's very complex. It's very difficult. I really applaud those who help people troubleshoot nutrition, because it's also as much psychology as it is physiology. So that's a very, very tough thing to undertake, I think. Even, and I can see why it's very overwhelming for somebody who's looking at how do I improve my nutrition to really find that answer. So again, I applaud people for going on that journey. And if you find something that really works for you, which I think through trial and error and diligence you can, then you're doing well.
Yeah.
I think at the end of the day though, you know, real food, that's like number one.
Right. Absolutely. So for some reason I've lost. Can you still see me on video?
Yes.
I've lost your video. What did I do? So strange. Anyway, we can keep talking.
Yeah.
So you were about to go into, talking about
Where were we?
You were at Rebar Fitness. You had opened the gym. You were wondering whether you were really serving your clients, given the training methodologies you were using,
right.
Because you were noticing the lack of, or the difficulties you were continuing to have in your own life, and using the same methods you were using with your clients. I'm imagining you did.
Right. Totally. Yeah. So I just felt that. Overall, there was a lot in check in my life, but for some reason, the thing that I was a professional in wasn't, right? Like helping people reconnect to their physicality. What I was doing wasn't working in the way I wanted it to, both professionally and personally. So it just got me like kind of thinking about it. And it also sort of got me thinking about this concept of like, what am I really teaching these people that come and pay me money? Am I just teaching them how to be out of pain? Am I just helping them purely to look a certain way that's going to help them be more confident, which is great. Mm-hmm. But to me, like this question kept coming into my mind, like why be stronger if we don't need to in our modern day? Like why learn all these movements and stuff? Like what is the original purpose of movement? I guess was really what I was thinking. Like what is the highest purpose of movement? So anyway, I was sort of going down that rabbit hole, and I came across two major trains of thought that were a divergence from classical strength and conditioning, and that was Ido Portal and MovNat. I saw both of them. I watched a lot of videos on both Ido and the founder of MovNat, Erwan Lacour. And as you probably have guessed, based on what I've said and based on my background in biology and archaeology, I gravitated towards MovNat. It just resonated with me in that someone who especially new gymnasts, because Ido Portal's stuff was a lot of, you know, capoeira and gymnastics oriented. It was very like beautiful, but a little bit flashy, a little bit extreme in my opinion. But still had some cool stuff. So I was interested, but MovNat to me was like, wow, okay, well this clearly is the original purpose of movement, right? Like to be able to move in a natural environment, like that makes a lot of sense to me. So logically I was convinced, but I was a little skeptical that there would actually be a method behind that. Like, okay, so we're just outside doing, like running around, like there can't really be a method behind that. Like,
yeah, right.
I just didn't really believe it, but something compelled me, and Abby was really supportive and was interested to are you still hearing me? Because
yep. I'm gotcha.
Getting, it's going up and down.
Nope, gotcha, loud and clear.
You got me loud and clear?
Yep.
So with, you know, with Abby's support, we found that
Abby's your wife. Abby's your wife. Just Abby, I don't think you've mentioned her name. Maybe you did.
Oh yeah, yeah. So with Abby's support, we found a retreat in Mexico with Erwan. Because I was like, if I'm going to learn this, I may as well learn from the guy who made it. And so we went. This was about almost 3 years ago now, and we ended up on the beach hanging out with Erwan and a pretty big group of people, and he started teaching us natural movement. And what was really interesting, unlike any other modality I did, we started on the ground, which was really cool. Just doing really basic stuff like side rolling, it's a lot of, you know, sitting, transitioning up to standing, being able to get up without using our hands, like basic stuff like what I've done for you guys in Whole Life Challenge. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, this is interesting. And there was some, like, even some martial art type stuff, which he connected to real world movement, which was really cool. But so I was a little skeptical at first. I was like, this is interesting. But then as it progressed, I just came to see like more and more pieces of the puzzle. And that included stuff that was really super fun and interesting, like being able to jump and land on a small object, being able to balance, which I hadn't tested since I was very young. And turns out my balance sucked. just like all these things, even the ground movement, being a wrestler, being on the ground all the time, I had these deficits, these patterns I was really clearly compensating for. And they weren't really like extreme. They weren't like, okay, now we're going to go into a full wheel back bridge and transition to, you know, it was like simple things. Like, can you sit on the ground with your butt on the floor with both, you know, knees, you know, in side bent sit where you're basically in that kind of classic shin box position.
Yep.
So that was really intriguing to me.
You couldn't do that. Is that what you're, that's what you're saying?
There was a lot that I couldn't do. Yeah.
I still struggle with that.
Yeah. So, and how could we be good at it if we don't do it anymore? Right.
Like
we don't sit on the ground anymore. So it was just missing. So,
yeah. For those of you that might wonder what we're talking about, that position, it looks like you are, your hips are at a 90 degree bend and your knees are at a 90 degree bend and everything's kind of lined up. So you're looking out over one leg straight for your thighs out straight. And then there's a 90 degree bend at your knee. And then the other leg's out to the side at 90 degrees. It's in a weird way. It looks like a kind of a weird swastika.
It's like what I tell people is if you're sitting on your butt with your knees pointed straight up toward the ceiling, almost as if you're gonna, you know, hang out and you're gonna probably rest on your own knees, and you just let both knees fall to
one side, right?
That's why
right.
we call it side bend sit.
Right.
What we want to be able to do, if you're listening to try to test this out, is sit in that position with both hips. The weight doesn't have to be equal distribution, but both butt cheeks should be pretty close to the ground. If you're 3 inches off the ground like I was, there's a major deficit in internal rotation of your hip. And guess what? That's going to affect all the other movements you do. And that's
And can you do that without your hands holding you up? Because that was a big thing for me, is that not only could I not do that, I couldn't do it without – I'd literally tip over if I didn't have my hands on the ground.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. it's humbling.
Yeah.
It's humbling in a lot of ways. And – so as I saw this system unfold, a couple things happened. One is I realized that a lot of this stuff is really missing in the fitness industry, especially for those that are a little bit older, looking to reclaim some of these movements that they hadn't done since they were 12 or so. You know, we live in a culture where you sit in elevated chairs and do nothing and then, you know, hop in a gym and throw around a barbell. It's not really addressing a lot of things that are natural to human beings that our joints need, that are, you know, put our joints through ranges of motion where they can kind of thrive and get that stimulative stress they need. So that was a big thing. The other thing was that there was this sort of halo theme of being strong to be capable, being strong to be helpful, being strong to be able to help another human being or to be able to like kind of thrive, not thrive, but be able to respond to a situation like a survival type situation where, you know, either your life is on the line or you need to go assist somebody else.
You're in Houston right now, given the predicament with the hurricane and you're trying to help others or help yourself.
Yeah. And I think that at the highest level, even what yogis are trying to cultivate in a lot of ways is that compassion, that heart to be able to make your life serve a purpose. And in this way, this is movement serving a purpose, which mm-hmm. is a beautiful, beautiful thing to me. And he's very right, because the basis of this system that Erwan's drawing off of isn't just purely evolutionary fitness. It was based on George Herbet's work, which came before him in the early to mid 1900s, which George Herbet was a French naval officer who traveled the world and just made a simple observation that, like, as we've become civilized, human beings have lost the ability to do really basic things, even save their own skin. Like, they couldn't even, a lot of people couldn't even, in a survival situation, get on a raft. And, you know, like, realistically, even this applies to modern day, because it doesn't, and I've seen this at certifications, it doesn't matter how many power snatches you can do, to be able to climb up and over a wall and up onto something requires a certain level of strength, conditioning, mobility, and really motor control, you know, like you're, you have to have the actual technique. In the same way wrestling, I can't overpower everything. I have to have the technique to change my body positions, to breathe, and to execute the movement. And that's what he noticed, was that, like, human beings don't have the technique nor the strength to perform in the real world anymore, outside our bubble of civilization.
He was saying that in the early 1900s?
Yep.
Wow. Yep. Was he an author? Was he an, like, where did his, did he get published? Like, how did this knowledge get transferred?
Well, it was lost in a lot of ways, for one, but he did publish a book called The Natural Method.
Huh.
And, you know, it was what he used, because he came home from his travels and implemented this a lot into the French military, and it persisted for a little while, but, you know, American, and a lot, you know, like, American fitness hasn't really looked to European history for guiding our ways, maybe other than Arnold Schwarzenegger, right? So, like, it was lost to a lot of, to beyond that small bubble of French culture in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And in some ways it was revived through some of parkour, which is more urban environments, mm-hmm. and a focus on especially jumping and vaulting and running. But Erwan did his research and really wanted to bring forth to the world this method that he went and tested himself out in the woods and out in the rainforest, and was discovered for this.
What was his purpose? Like, was he a trainer? Was he you know, like, why did he bother doing this?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And he's written a couple articles about that, but really I think that he went through the gamut of becoming capable as a youth in a lot of ways. He did some Olympic lifting or some, you know, traditional weightlifting. He did karate. He had that martial arts background.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was just looking for more in a lot of ways, mm-hmm. the same way I was. And
right.
He, I think, did some basic training with, like, the early version of parkour, where it was sort of like stunting type movements, like,
right.
where he was just testing his, a lot of it being his courage and his mental fortitude, like, right. hanging off of cranes and doing, like, totally crazy things.
Mm-hmm.
But I know he stumbled across George Herbet's work and was really intrigued by it because, again, it incorporated some of this, like, physical competence, like, mental toughness type stuff, but it also addressed a lot of things that parkour or the rest of the world really weren't doing as well.
Mm-hmm.
So he was really, you know, and he was a nature lover like myself. I grew up, you know, like a lot of us do, running around in the woods and that freedom that's associated with that, and just wanted to really create, you know, he wanted to build off of George Herbet's work, which was very good, but it was also, back then there wasn't a lot of science behind anything. So what he did is he battle tested it in the field. He went and learned and just basically, he didn't just do George Herbet's workouts. He just went and took the kind of the idea, the philosophy, and went out there and just figured out, okay, in the real world, what works, what doesn't work? What am I trying to, what is the goal? I'm trying to build efficiency first and then adaptability, and sort of hashed out this whole method for being competent in real world environments, that being natural environments, urban environments, modern day environments. But the overlying principle being developing efficiency in real world movements, developing mm-hmm. real world capability. And so he wasn't really a trainer at the time. He was more just doing it for his own, I guess it was his own vision, you know, mm-hmm. like he wasn't like, oh, I'm a trainer and I need the next best thing.
Mm-hmm.
He was a man on a mission and he got discovered for that mission. Mm-hmm. And he just happened to be a very good, gifted teacher as well.
Right.
So that's sort of how that came about. He was probably first discovered, I guess, by Chris McDougall, who wrote an article about him.
Before, this is the Chris McDougall of the Born to Run fame.
Yeah, so before that even happened, he wrote an article for Men's Health all about Erwan and what he was doing. And, you know, just basically summed up this idea that, you know, by working for these tank tread abs, as he put it, and just running on a treadmill and lift, throwing around some weights or using some machines, this is like the domesticated version of fitness in a lot of ways. Are we really capable in the real world? Is our movements, in one word, practical in a lot of ways? And in a lot of ways, our movements really aren't practical. Even modern strength and conditioning, like the deadlift, is definitely practical. But how many times have you really snatched something overhead in real life? You know, like maybe once or twice. I'm not saying that it isn't, but in your day-to-day movement, how often are you doing these things? You know, so he wanted to create something that would have a lot of scope for the people who really needed it most, us civilized, you know, people who haven't really been moving in natural environments anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, so he created this method, and what I really liked about it was the breath, in the sense of starting all the way from something like breathing and refining that all the way to really high level stuff like vaulting. So like learning how to almost reverse engineer the developmental process of moving. Second, the idea that we should connect to our environment, because at the end of the day, that question I had, that sort of burning question of what is the purpose of movement? Well, the purpose of movement is to perform tasks in complex environments. It's why we have a brain to begin with. So if you take away the environment and you sterilize it, you're going to inhibit your ability to move fundamentally. So that's why the yogi is never going to become stable, even if they strength train, because they still, like, stability is an interaction between organism and environment. So we need environment, right? A flat level floor and a couple postures or even a barbell isn't enough to really build real world stability and real world capability.
So what I hear you saying is we need more virtual reality. So we need to create the unstable environment through, I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. We need more technology to simulate what you get in the real world. Jesus Christ.
Right.
Right. Yeah. Right. Look, It's so funny, you know, is technology, in some ways, technology is literally trying to reproduce what's already there.
Of course.
You know, like it's a weird thing. I mean, I don't think that's all of technology, but...
I'd say most of technology is solving problems that we've created for ourselves.
Yeah.
And I agree, not all of it. There's like tons of technology, especially in the, you know, the medical fields that have been instrumental in improving the quality of life of human beings. But it's just like anything, you know, like that doesn't mean technology in general has been good for us.
Yeah.
I think that more technology isn't going to solve our physical problems as we age at all. It's going to do the opposite. And that's what MovNat is. It's about getting back to the basics of movement, doing the things that you did when you were a kid, but better, and enriching your environment and reconnecting to your natural world and doing it in a way that's very simple and organized, and using principles of progression the same way you would for strength and conditioning, like not just like throwing you out there and being like, all right, jump from rock to rock, take your shoes off, go climb a tree. Like, no, it's we start in a gym, we learn how to sit again like a human being on the ground, we learn how to move on the ground like crawling, we relearn gait mechanics like walking and
when you first learned this at this in Mexico, did you immediately come back and start doing the best you could at teaching your clients what you had learned, or did it take was it a process?
Yeah, that was actually what created my role in MovNat in a lot of ways. Was I learned all this information, and it was organized fairly well through what Erwan did, and but there wasn't like it wasn't geared towards trainers. Like this is how you troubleshoot this, and this is what you do if this isn't working. It was just like, no, this is what we're doing. You do it and you get better at it. Because again, this wasn't a certification.
Yeah.
So I started sort of implementing it in the ways that I felt like I could, starting with basics, especially the balancing progressions we had learned, working toward a deep squat, like all that kind of stuff. And then I went to the certification, which was very, very good. It was organized even better. But there was still that like toolkit was a little bit lacking, and like, okay, so again, I'm a professional and somebody can't do the deep squat. What do I do?
Right.
And that wasn't really totally, or where do I start as a, for, you know, like I have somebody who walks in the door and they can't do anything. So where do I start?
Mm-hmm.
And so that was sort of like what I had to do.
Because you're also bridging, you know, you're also bridging with a new person like that. You're also bridging you want to give them enough stuff that allows them to feel like they're accomplishing things and progressing. Like, there's a psychology element to this as well. If you just said, all we're going to do is sit on the floor, breathe, and move, and swivel our hips back and forth just until we get that 3-inch gap reduced, I don't know that you'd have a lot of success in getting a lot of clients, because your clients would be like, after 3 sessions of breathing and move, swiveling the hips, would be like, what the hell is this? So you have to, you had to couple those things, which is a trick.
Give them that dose of like, it's a couple things put together, like you're alluding to. It's like giving them what they need, giving them what makes them feel really capable and like they can do it, and then giving them like the path to like, hey, this is where this can go too, and like the challenge behind it. So you kind of have to put those 3 things together, like, because if you just give someone what you think they need, well, that's not really addressing the psychology, like you said. Like, we all have reasons we're there. So you have to address why they're there. And then you have to be able to competently help them reach those goals and also do what they need more than what they think they need as well. So you have to weave that all together. And that's the skill of a really good trainer. So that's what I had to problem solve coming in, because nobody in Westport, Connecticut was going to be interested in this idea of evolutionary fitness and the high goal is to be able to climb trees and jump over.
Right, right. That's businessman's no buy-in.
None.
That's right.
None.
Right.
But I will tell you, after, I like to call this mental progression, because after months of doing this, many of my clients, including owners of these big companies, their goals transition to those type of things in the long run. Like, they were like, I had one client who was an architect in his 60s, and the idea that he could go on a site, on a project, climb over a wall, and then his 20-year-old counterparts couldn't do it, or they would like do it like horribly flopping around. And you know, those like the apex of his pride. And that's really what he was doing it for. He's like, oh, I want to be able to keep up with my kids. That's really like an important thing to me. And the same guy's like crawling now. He'll like change level, crawl under a desk, come to the center of it during a presentation and talk about his architecture. Like, he's just, you know, like, people come to life with this stuff. But I agree, like, you can't throw it in their face. Like, this is what you're supposed to do. And you need, you know, like, you need to climb trees and this and that. So, like, my strategy in a lot of ways was just to kind of familiarize them with some of their deficits, you know, like ask them, can you get up without using your hands? Like, try it. Cool. Okay. Try some basic crawling. Okay. Let's see. Let's do some hanging. Oh, good job. You could do that. You know, like, find something they can do, you know, for sure. And then show them a little bit of what's possible and what, you know, what's, and just show them that they're going to be safe in that process too. I think that's really important, because you don't want to challenge someone and hurt them or them think that you're nuts, like thinking they can do that.
So, right. Right.
And that's what I had to sort of help reverse engineer for MoveNat in a lot of ways, because we had a lot of really brilliant movers leading these. You know, I just asked Irwan, I'm like, can I help just refine this a little bit to like match the language of professionals who maybe don't even move that well themselves yet, but want to implement some of this stuff?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, yes, absolutely. So I just helped to reorganize the curriculum a little bit, you know, work, just kind of model it so that a trainer looking at this can see, okay, this is how you progress somebody through this. The same way, again, I looked at the chalkboard as a youth, like, okay, we're going to work on X, Y, and Z over time, and we're going to start with X, and then that'll prepare us for Y, and then that prepares us for Z. And that's what we did with movement in a lot of ways. We start, you know, with basic things, and we just kind of work up the chain, but we do it in a way where we're not stuck in one area. We're working on everything, or at least a few key domains, and allowing people to, you know, feel comfortable with what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very, very cool.
Yeah.
And that brings you up to kind of where you are now. Now tell me a little bit about you and your training personally. Like, how do you navigate your time and your day? Do you, like, in terms of your morning routine, your workouts, the time you spend working out, what's it look like for you?
That's a good question. Yeah. For a while I was a little bit stubborn and just clinged on to my powerlifting and stuff because I was afraid I was going to burn off some muscle mass. Like, a lot of people who look at this are probably thinking like, oh, I'm going to lose my strength and conditioning if I switch over to movement.
Mm-hmm.
And I slowly realized that, first of all, like, I'm not doing my body a service by doing this. I'm reinforcing things that, or I'm highly specializing in things that I don't need to specialize in. You know, lifting is a domain in movement. So I don't want to just, out of these eight or so domains of movement, I don't want to only be good at one of them. I want to get good at all of them, but still not be horrible at the one I'm good at, you know? So it was really learning how to nurture my strengths and then improve upon my weaknesses. So I slowly let go of how much I could deadlift, but I still deadlift a lot. And I still lift, but I also focus on, okay, can I lift things other than a bar?
Mm-hmm.
And for whatever reason, the way I train, I haven't lost a pound. If anything, I'm leaner, I'm stronger, but I haven't lost any muscle mass. So
do your workouts look like a, give me a little bit more, what it looks like to train with you in on a day, on a particular day.
So like my training myself is I basically every day I do some sort of ground movement. Cause ground movement I think is the foundation of all movement. So I can sort of always be teaching myself, always be sort of restoring my joints, always be tuning into my body through ground movement. So I just work through practical positions, starting on my back, working up to my feet. I have actually a couple series online where people can follow along to do this type of stuff, including Whole Life Challenge. So I do that.
Yeah, because you have a lot in Whole Life Challenge. I mean that you've done. You also have. Yeah. Is it on your? Where? If somebody wanted to see that, is it on YouTube or where do you have it?
I just came out recently with it was sort of inspired by yoga, but a primary sequence for natural movement.
Oh, cool.
And that can be found on YouTube under the MovNat channel. And it's 30 minutes total, and it's led by my voice and shown by my example, and it's just the basics, the foundational movements.
Cool.
In a sequence that can be done as often as you want.
I love sequences like that. I'm currently playing with one. I add things to it, I take things away from it, but I love to have sequences because they remove a lot of the thinking that gets in the way of doing. You know, like if I have to think too much before I start, I can think of three other things that I should be doing instead.
that's
usually
my job, right?
Not good,
so, I mean,
right?
That's what I've done. And we're going to create an intermediate and an advanced sequence too, so that progression can happen. So I do something like that usually almost every day. 2 to 3 times a week, I'll do an organized session where the emphasis is probably either strength, power, or technique. So I'll be focusing on 2 or 3 things, usually on a 1 month rotating cycle. So like for a month, I may focus on my deadlift and my power traverse with like a climbing movement, or my pop up, or even a jump. You know, I might do like a broad jump, but in MovNat world, it's also to a precision landing,
right,
instead of just like onto a box. So I'm trying to improve both my physiology and my my motor control, my motor skill, at the same time on 1 or 2 techniques.
Now, do you organize it in what would be considered a workout? So like it's timed or it's got reps or sets, or do you just, because I think that's one of the things that for me makes MovNat particularly challenging is it may not necessarily fit into a scheme where I can just say, okay, I'm doing 3 sets of 10 or 10 minute AMRAP or, you know, whatever
it
is.
It does.
In my mind, it doesn't do that as easily, but you're probably working on making that as easy as it is in other ways.
That's been another part, you know, with my background in programming through my learning time and, you know, classical, again, GPP based philosophy. I've applied that to natural movement in a lot of ways because it's really helpful to organize the training process and use reps so that you're getting, so you can control the dosage to make sure that you're eliciting the adaptations you want in your body, both from a physiological perspective and from a neural perspective and a learning perspective. So totally. So I personally count reps. I do sets and reps, and in the same way, my template would be less similar to like classical CrossFit in the sense of it not being times, not AMRAP or anything like that. It's going to be more in the classical strength and conditioning where we're going to do sets, even supersets, maybe five sets of three for the deadlift and five sets of maybe five for the broad jump. I'm going to take a break between the two movements. I'm going to rest. I'm going to do it again. I might increase the amount of that I'm lifting each time, or the distance of the jump or whatever. So I organize it in that way, and I revolve what I'm working on each month.
And then where's the conditioning fit in? Because it sounds like, you know, I don't know. Do you feel like you have endurance or stamina or that serves you for, like, if you had to go run a 10K or 5K, or is that not part of your training?
Oh no. So like, yeah, the gait domain includes running, right? And sprinting. So that has to be included, of course, to be balanced. So first part of the workout is the warm up ground movement. Second part of the workout is either strength, power, or technique, working on all those or one of those or whatever, for whatever you're trying to isolate and improve. The third part of an organized workout, which again, I'll get to unorganized workouts too, because that's a part of MoveNat, but yep. This is an organized workout, would be what we call the combo. And the combo is, again, more along the lines of a classical CrossFit style. You know, we're doing either stuff on purely on time, we're doing it based on reps, we're doing it based on times through a rotation of movements, you know, like, so, yeah, that's where we're getting some of that more anaerobic conditioning there. Mm-hmm. For sure. So, but we try to emulate natural conditions as much as possible. Meaning in nature, you don't go out and jump on a log five times and then stop and then wait 30 seconds, walk over to something else, do something else five times and stop. And, you know, it's more almost like you guys do in CrossFit, like we'll, mm-hmm. Crawl to a point and then jump up on something and then transition down. And then we'll do some sprawls and then we'll jog back to the beginning and just continue. We'll make like a loop usually. Mm-hmm. And in like parkour world, that would be called a route. So we make a tangible path through an area, mm-hmm. that includes obstacles and includes a lot of movement. And we usually teach people to not take breaks between, but to learn how to delegate their energy so that they can continuously move through the whole thing. As long, you know, for 10 minutes or whatever it is. So you're learning how to breathe. You're learning how to optimize your efficiency through that. So
cool.
That covers more the anaerobic side of things. There's a little bit, of course, anytime you're doing anaerobic conditioning, there's aerobic involved as well. But yeah. We also do pure aerobic stuff too, or what would be considered mostly pure aerobic stuff, like running. So the meathead in me used to hate running, used to despise running, actually. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because it would hurt. Now that I have rebuilt my body in a lot of ways, running is, I wouldn't say I'm good at it because I'm 200 pounds and I'm wired for explosiveness. But, you know, I've built up my running conditioning on to be able to, you know, run 5 miles without a problem, to be able to run barefoot, to be able to, you know, so we're trying to work on this in a really holistic way. And we're mm-hmm. also trying to take away some of the structure as well. So in a typical week for me, I'm going to do some ground movement each day. 2 to 3 times, I'm going to do an organized workout in the sense that I just explained, where there's ground yep. movement, there's I'm working on something in particular, and then
there's
there's
a route or something like that. Yeah,
something
cool.
like that. And okay. if you're stuck in a home and you're thinking like, okay, I only have a room to do this in, you could do. It doesn't have to be that way, but that's yep. that's one way to do it.
Yep.
And then I'm running for sure. Maybe 2 to 5 times a week, I'll do some running. I'll vary, you know, my pace or my, you know, my distance or whatever. And then I also leave enough energy for unorganized training, meaning playing with my son, going mm-hmm. to a playground. Just going outside and enjoying nature and stepping off the trail without it being like I'm trying to elicit an adaptation or anything. And that may sound like a lot, like, okay, he's doing all this stuff, but like, I live this part. This is my job, yeah,
right?
You can get a minimum effective dosage of all those things either by A, reducing the load of all of them and just doing less of each, or B, you can cycle, right? So like you can have an emphasis on running 1 month where you're just doing the bare minimum of all the other stuff. And then you can work more on strength. Then you can work more on whatever technique you want 1 month. So like if you're thinking like, wow, that's a lot, really this can be streamlined quite a bit.
Well, I love, you know, about what you're saying, and as I get older and think about these things, look, you can't achieve the ultimate physiology of your body in 6 months, or even a year, you know. And if you start to broaden your thinking around the length of your thinking around, okay, here's what I'm working on. I'm not going to get this in 3 months, or like, there's no boot camp that's going to immediately inject. It's not, you know, like in the Matrix when Neo gets the injection of all the stuff that just, you know, that's the Matrix, the movie, software programming, right? God, if we could do that, it'd be amazing, but I don't see that happening anytime soon. And when you relax a little bit into, okay, I'm on the path, and the path, it might feel like a slope, a really gentle, it might not feel like I'm climbing Mount Everest. It's a very gentle slope. But if you measure your progress year after year, seeing that you're improving some, that's really what we're talking about. And you can slow down your overactive, hyper-vigilant mind and need for type A winning, and just allow yourself that you can't move faster than nature. You can't move faster than your, you know, and I think when there's the breadth of work that you're talking about doing, you can't cram it on, and you can't cram it all into 6 weeks, you know, or 8 weeks or 2 months or 3 months, whatever.
Totally agreed. And here's the beautiful thing. Skill development is timeless.
Right.
It's something that you can continue being more skillful in movement to the day you die.
Right.
You might be a little bit limited by your physiology, but hey, listen, like when I'm 40, I'm not interested in competing, or 50, I'm not interested in competing with the physiology of a 20-year-old.
Right.
So I have to use better technique if I want to be effective in the real world, right?
Yeah.
I want to feel like I'm floating when I'm moving. I don't really care how fast or how hard or what my muscles look like.
Yep.
And I see this with my son, you know, like everybody thinks that kids are the apex of movement. It's like, well, physiology wise, they are, because their strength, their conditioning, their resilience and durability is extremely high, but their actual motor skill isn't really that good.
Right.
It's certain. And as adults, as teachers, as examples, our skill set should be better than a child's. Like my son is learning how to jump from me. I shouldn't be learning how to jump from him. I mean, right. There's lessons in how he's learning how to jump for sure on his own.
Things he's born with, like squatting, is a different story. I mean, I think most of us could learn a lot from the way our kids squat.
And we should be down there ourselves so they don't forget that it's important to do it as an adult. You know, like we need to be modeling these behaviors to them and show how easy and awesome it is to be an adult and how skillful you can be. So yeah, I totally agree.
Danny, if somebody wanted to play around with doing some of these workouts at home, I know you've already mentioned your YouTube channel. What's the best way to engage with MoveNat and with the movement and with the kind of the methodology of which you're talking about? How do they do it?
I think that in an ideal world, you would definitely show up to a workshop, because our instructors are highly trained to deliver this type of stuff, like how to implement it, how to learn it. Getting hands-on coaching is irreplaceable.
Yep.
The next best thing you could do is
you offer those all over the world. I mean, those are all over you have world. A schedule, one a month. Are you doing them that often? How often do they take place?
More than that.
Okay.
We have two types of workshops. We have a 1-day workshop, which is done by local instructors, usually ones that run like a licensed facility.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way, you go to a CrossFit box, where we have a growing amount of MoveNat specific gyms throughout the world, and a lot of these trainers who have at least gone through our level 2 certification, if not our level 3, are running some of these 1-day workshops, and you'll get all the basics, and it's very, very approachable, and it's like for beginners. It's not for the person who's looking to, you know, take over the world and be the next Tarzan or whatever.
Yeah.
So we have those. Then we have 2-day workshops, which you saw, they sort of parallel our certification, and you get a lot more out of that in terms of movement, and you get other people helping you. But it definitely is more rigorous, right? Mm-hmm. So you have to be have a certain degree of durability because you're going to be doing things that are probably going to be even above where you're at.
Yeah, I can speak to that. I mean, it was rough. The 2-day course is, you know, I mean, like you, it meets you where you are. There's no, it's not like you're going to be called upon to do 40 pull-ups, you know, suddenly. But you
have to be comfortable being sore, right? You have to be comfortable with this idea of being sore.
Right. Yeah, and it was a really, really awesome 2 days. Very well spent.
And then especially if you are ambitious and you want to really learn the underlying philosophy and methodology behind MovNat, taking the certification, even if you're not a professional, is a good experience for sure. And it's very doable. Level one, the tests are not easy, but they're attainable. And you know, we're increasing our resources to help people become more prepared for that anyway. The next best thing you could do, if a workshop or traveling, or if there's not one in your area, whatever, if it's not feasible for you right now, is to just follow us online. We have a downloadable, like, definitely follow our newsletter, which has a lot of resources. And we're going to be actually releasing our almost version of the workout of the day, which we've done in the past, called the MOD, the movement of the day.
Cool.
That's probably going to be coming out by early next year. So you'll be able to download some sort of like a an on-ramp, for a better term, to where you're kind of getting prepared for the movements that you're going to do. And then there'll be some sort of a feed to where you'll be able to just continue to practice some MovNat. Of course, that's you know, like any generalized programming, it's not going to meet you exactly where you are. So it would be great to do that in combination with a workshop or whatever.
Yep.
And then, you know, we have 4,000 trainers worldwide that you can hook up with on our website under Find a Trainer. We have a trainer locator map where you can learn all about MovNat.
Very cool.
In person. So yeah, we've got a decent amount of resources to get people started.
And if somebody wants to ask you questions personally, like they heard the podcast and they have something they want to ask you about, are you a Twitter guy, LinkedIn? Where are you? Where can somebody send you something?
I'm not as LinkedIn as I'd like to be.
You're on Instagram, aren't you?
So,
your wife is certainly on Instagram, for God's sakes. She's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. So you can find me natural.mover on Instagram for sure. Email is always good, danny@movenat.com. And, you know, I try to really live where in the content that I'm putting out. And then Instagram is sort of the side of, showing how I do it and a little bit more about me. So between Instagram and the newsletter, I write for our newsletter all the time.
Okay, cool. Cool. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I mean, I'll tell you, I get in these conversations with people and I have a hard time, you know, it's funny. I listen to Joe Rogan occasionally when I have 3 hours. They're long podcasts. But I get it. I get why they go on as long as they do, because you get in these conversations and a lot of times you don't unearth the things you really want to talk about for an hour or an hour and a half. And then you get to them and then you're in them and then you're like, well, I don't want to stop. And, you know, but at the same time, it's this balancing between, you know, what's right for the conversation and what's right for the listeners. And,
I think you do a great job.
I really appreciate
what you do with Whole Life Challenge. It's really awesome. And I'm very privileged to be a part of it.
Thanks. And it's been great to have you as part of it. And we'll hope we continue that over the, you know, time to come. Cause I think with your message and your training and the whole methodology is something the world needs more of.
Yeah. And I would ask your readers to dig a little deeper than just the ground movement. Cause that's what I have on there. It's a good start. I try to make it really approachable and simple. To implement in a simple practice to complement whatever else you're doing. But it gets a lot spicier and more exciting and even more conditioning and all that stuff you look for as you get better in the rest of MovNat. So continue to dig a little deeper if this at all piques you or interests you.
Cool. Well, we'll leave it at that. And we'll be seeing a lot more of you, I'm sure, in the future.
Thanks so much, Andy.
All right. Take care. The Whole Life Podcast is produced by our podcast team, Winslow Jenkins, Becca Borowski, and Ernie Hurtado. You can find all of our episodes, links, and complete show notes at wholelifechallenge.com/podcast.
The way that I've found is the best way to listen to podcasts is to subscribe so that episodes automatically get delivered right to your mobile device. You can do that in any podcast app on your phone. And hey, if you like the podcast, please do me a favor. Go to iTunes and give it a 5-star rating and recommend it to your friends. I'm Andy Petronic, and thanks so much for listening.